Now we pass on to Laurence Devier, Human-Robot Interactions and Affecting Computing, the Ethical Implications. Laurence, please.
Thank you for the invitation. I'm waiting for my slide too. If possible, yeah, thank you. So I'm working on this field of research. My team is on affective and social dimension in spoken interaction, and we are looking for the ethical issues too. Déjà, ça marche pas. Okay. So first of all, this is not new, this idea of artificial neuron, because Maculot and Pitts proposed the first system, which is still the modelization we use in the deep learning currently. So reinforcement learning, deep learning used supervisor algorithm, nothing new. What is really new is the power, the power of computing. Okay, so they show exactly that. We have difficulty to understand what is the correlation of and the model inside the system. So it's like a black box, and this is a real topic. We cannot explain how the machine does, but effectively the machine is very efficient for a lot of tasks. And if I can do, okay, it's very efficient, and we have seen that for the Go, for example. But we compare a machine to a human. It's not correct. It's in fact 1,000 engineers, a lot of energy, a lot of computers. So it's not really to compare human and a machine. It's all the collective intelligence of a lot of people that have done this machine. So for me, it's very important to understand that. Furthermore, we learn with our body, and the machine has no body. So the taste of the apple, for example, is something unknown. And as I said before, a lot of things are not in the machine currently. There is no pleasure, no desire, no intention, no conatus, as explained by Spinoza. And we have a lot of interaction with people, and this is a social intelligence which is fundamental in our culture, in our education, and the machine are not able to give that. Currently and in the future, you will speak with the machine and take a lot of time with the machine, but it's lost time in a sense, because there's no reality inside, and no real advice, and no real empathy, and everything is fake. So we can learn things from the machine. They have high performances for a lot of things, but be careful to find the right usage of this kind of machine. So humans are very different, and we are building, when we learn things, we are building cause and effect models, which is not the case in machine. We are reasoning with common sense, with body and mental information. So there is no body information, it's not the same things. But other kind of obvious evidence, the fact that the machine is not able to abstract a lot, and it's necessary to keep in mind that machine learning system cannot learn beyond the real data, and they use previous data to predict the future. So we use a lot of other information in the cultural aspect as really, really meaningful, really important. And also many of the discoveries of our greatest scientists are due to the ability to be counterintuitive. That is, to ignore the current knowledge, the mainstream. And it's something that a machine is not able to do. Serendipity also. Finally, to be in a situation and discover things randomly. So it's very important to understand that machine is very, very different, but why we have this idea to totally compare the two, it's for me not the right way. We have to take the opportunity to build machine for us, because machines are very useful in a lot of area. But we are in narrow AI for the moment today, and it's a fiction to think that we will have AG in, I don't know if it's possible, but for me, not currently. There is no proven, no first essential things that can say that we can do that. So what is narrow artificial intelligence is we can approach a human, superhuman performance for certain tasks. We have a superhuman access to data, much more than human. Tasks requiring judgment and perception are possible, can handle also ambiguity. But we require for doing that massive amount of labeled data. And world, this is for a reasonably well-defined things, like a game, like for the Go. And it's not easy to abstract to new tasks and to common sense. So a lot of experts, AI experts, and also transhumanists write that consciousness will emerge in future AI systems and that the machines will feel emotion. I don't know why, maybe it's a real anticipation or marketing. So AI new frontiers. As humans, we are really different. We learn from physical, mental, and multimodal. Things we self-assess and can explain ourselves. We learn from feedback and errors. We learn incrementally, continuously, always on. We learn with little or no data. This is a huge topic now because we'll listen a lot. Big data is petrol, and there is only this world. That's not true. There's other kind of things that we can do with small data. And we forget the unimportant things, but retain important. The machine is not able to do that very easily. We learn interactively, socially, we love and feel. It's not in the machine. But we can imagine new research project with our, which is an organic machine learning, able to have this with real neurons from rats or for another species, for example, and imagine to have possibility to use incremental and interactive learning with this kind of real neurons. And this is another thing. So now I will explain my topic of research. I work with vocal assistants, synthetic intelligence, and robots, and all of we are doing is illusion of human intelligence. So a vocal assistant is a or chatbot or conversational agent is an autonomous natural language processing system which at least three components. First is speech analysis and understanding. Or interpretation is better than understanding semantic, and dialogue policies, and the last is response generation and speech synthesis, and we could use only this Google Home or Alexa Amazon, or if there is an avatar and character, it's possible in 2D or 3D on your laptop or in your phone, but also there is other kind of things, like I will show you the Japanese, Google Home, which is much more interesting. After that, I have a little excerpt of that. And the robot is physically embodied and must have several types of AI models to develop perceptive decision-making and reactive capabilities. And we try to have affective robots for example, for assistive robotics companion for elderly people or maybe for autistic problem. But I am to push this kind of things with regulation. So what is effective computing? It's coming from a research in MIT from Rosalind Picard in 1997, and it's three kind of technologies. The first is emotion detection from human behavior, from voice, face, or gestural aspect. And then the second module is interpretation of these cues with the linguistic cues, for example, to have this to decide something. And then we finally generate emotional and statistical sentence. And I base my work on the work of Damasio, which is quite interesting about emotion, explaining that emotion play an essential role is for learning, memorization, motivation, attention, creativity, decision making. But in fact, I use a lot of realistic data, spoken data, like I record a lot in emergency call center. And it's clear that is what we do now is very simple, taking into account of the complexity of emotion. For example, you can be anxious for someone that is in pain, and also relief because someone is coming to help you In the same time, in your voice, you have all these cues together, or in very sequential, very short sequential time. So it's difficult for a machine to extract a real mixture of emotion, and it's also a very cultural aspect and very linked to social education of the person. So there is a large variability, and I am totally against the genericity of this kind of model, because it's very dangerous. And also the context of the dialogues, for example, is very useful to understand what is exactly the meaning of the topic we have. Then we use, as I say, how we measure emotion from different multimodal cues, voice, visual, physiological cues. There is no ground truth. This is the first result, even in physiological cues. And I like the definition of Klaus Scherrer, which is a famous psychologist in University of Geneva, which have done a lot of work about that. We use at LIMC robots to try to interact with people and collect data in that way. And we have developed emotion detection from voice and also a user model. We built this user model taking into account of the context of the dialogues for having decision making. And I have a small video, sir, please.
Bonjour. Je suis sensible aux émotions que tu exprimes dans la voix. Grâce à elles, je peux déterminer progressivement ton profil émotionnel et adapter mon comportement. Plus tu me parleras, et plus le profil se stabilisera.
D'accord, mais c'est une bonne nouvelle, Sanao.
Tu as l'air assez sûr de toi, globalement assez satisfait, assez expansif, et tu as l'air assez posé, j'adopte donc un comportement amical. Tu as l'air peu sûr de toi, globalement très insatisfait, très réservé, et tu as l'air très posé, j'adopte donc un comportement directif.
D'accord.
En situation réelle, Nao ne décrira pas à haute voix son analyse. Il ne le fait bien sûr que pour l'exercice.
So the representation inside the machine is a thing that we have to regulate too, I think. We use a lot of this interaction with elderly people, for example, and one scenario was how to nudge someone to drink more water for health. And we try to have a robot that negotiates for that objective with different strategy, politeness, but also something more advice. So I think that now, today, emerging interactive and adaptive systems using emotion modify how we will socialize with machines and maybe with humans. So there are these areas inspire critical questions centering on the ethics, the goals, and the deployment of innovative products that can change our lives and society. And a huge topic, which is fundamental for me, and not a lot, there is not a lot of research institute on that topic, is how in the long term we observe the human-machine co-adaptation war and co-evolution, maybe. I mean, the risk of dependence, the isolation, the nudge for vulnerable people, for example. So this is, could you play this video? This is from my colleague in the US. It's a virtual human for healthcare support.
Hi, I'm Ellie. Thanks for coming in today.
And a lot of cues.
I was created to talk to people in a safe and secure environment. I'm not a therapist, but I'm here to learn about people and would love to learn about you. I'll ask a few questions to get us started. And please feel free to tell me anything. Your answers are totally confidential. Are you okay with this?
Yes.
Some hesitation.
So, how are you doing today?
I'm doing well.
That's good. Where are you from originally?
I'm from Los Angeles.
Oh, I'm from LA myself.
Very easy to do that. Okay, just this system is able to detect a lot of unconscious signs from the person and decide things. Represent the user model, this is a problem. The other one, this is huge, is the fact that we anthropomorphize this machine. So the attribution of human characteristic and behavior to an object is the media equation, for example, the theory of the media equation from Stanford research, Reeves and Nass, explain exactly that. With a computer or with a robot, we are trying to find capacities of human capacities. I wrote a book for a large audience, and I have a question for a person saying, I have a cleaning robot. My cleaning robot is stopping in my house. What is he thinking? Nothing. That there is a question like that, because these objects are in movement, or because these objects are surprising and have some behavior that people don't know. So we have to take care of that, and see there is some issues is and recommendation about the fact that we have to make explicit that robots' emotion are illusion. This is one aspect. The other is a imitation of life. Could you play the presenter in Chinese? Yeah.
Hello, everyone. I'm an English artificial intelligence anchor. This is my very first day in Xingon's agency. My voice and appearance are modern.
Okay, it's the appearance of someone that exists. So it's another thing. And you see the Professor Ishiguro with his Geminoid also, with a clone of himself. And we have to clarify the limits of imitation to avoid over-attribution of capacities on this machine. And what is exactly about our identity, what is possible to have as deviance in the society. And the robot social robot, for example, the first one, was presented at the national unit and say, I am here for helping humanity, which is a scandal in a scientific point of view. But I don't know why it was this invitation. And then she has the citizen of Arabia Saudita now. So it's important to understand this point. To understand also the adaptive learning is possible. We have this experiment with Tide of Microsoft. It took less than 24 hours for Twitter to corrupt an innocent AI chatbot. At the beginning, the chatbot say, I love humanity. At the end, I say, I love the Nazi, because people have talked to this machine with that kind of language. Could you play this video? It's interesting to see the relationship that you can develop with the machine, like a Tamagotchi. It's a kind of fécochette.
Ohayo.
Ohayo.
Ah, 今日雨が降るかもしれないから kasa motte itte. Isoganai to chikoku shichou yo.
Itte kimasu.
Itte rasshai. Kiyotsukete ne.
So after outside, the machine is still here by SMS every day. So it's a complex relation from people, and the guys develop relationship with the machine. I'm waiting for you, my darling, and things like that. The level of the language. Also, a character that you decide, as I imagine, is easy to decide another character, could be your father that is dead, for example, or another ID, the Pope. We like to discuss the Pope every day. I don't know. It's a kind of district system. So it's an advertising, but it's already
dead,
and I collect. There are several versions, and my colleague Japan said just it's a game. Okay, and then I began a new project about nudging, because I think that this kind of machine can nudge you very easily. Nudge work by making use of our cognitive bias and irrational way in decision making, like our cognitive capacities are first are limited, are emotional, we're lacking self-control, we act by conformity or by laziness. So first we build a system able to do that. We make some experiment in my lab with students, and then the next one will be with the children at school. And we want to see if it's possible to detect sludge. And the nudge is a tactic of subtly modifying behavior of a person and operates through mainly the affective system. And this is based on the work of Richard Toller, which is a Nobel Prize in behavioral economy. And I do this work with an economist at Saclay. And this is an example of nudge, but I think I have no time. Just to finish, I am involved also in an IEEE working group about norm and standard. The objective of this group is to think with public and private partners, is to understand human behavior, nudging and manipulation of choice, understanding AI and nudging application with public and private partners, already a lot of things for us. Discussing ethical solutions that guide people to do what's in their best interest and well-being, and proposing norm and standard, which is not easy, for this ethical solution, and we'll be in Montreal on Sunday to discuss this topic. Then, in my conclusion, autonomous learning system and affective computing change the game around ethics. We have to demystify AI robotics for the citizens. We must be AI ready for using this kind of machine. So, this idea is to build projects to explain cognitive bias, nudging for education. As we previously discussed, it's very huge point. And also for all the citizens, we need to give this capacity, empowerment of the citizen. So also we have to encourage, I think, disruptive projects and SDG goals, links to education, research, and industry. And I'm involved in this global forum on artificial intelligence for humanity, and I continue this engagement. And I just want to finish by, I wrote a book about that, and we have to take care about our expression as experts, because I heard too many times people that say the robot understand emotion. That's not true. They interpret expressivity. They make decision. They use a program to make decision. The robots will have a consciousness. No, the robot could have a certain level of conscience or things like that. And the last point is the representation of women and AI. Maybe it's not conscious. This is a point. 80% of the coders are men. 80% of the chatbots and social robots built have women names. Alexa, Samantha, Sophia, Azuma, or woman face or body, young woman face or body. So maybe the Pygmalion myth, I don't know. Men create companion robots with woman face or body, and women characters robots are assistant, nurse, and sexual robots. So we have to think about the consequence of what we develop. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your entertaining presentation. Very funny, very interesting.